إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما يفعل الله بعذابكم إن شكرتم وآمنتم وكان الله شاكرا عليما رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My respected brothers and my sisters, today inshallah in my half an hour talk, I would like to give you some perspective of the current situation we all are going through, and to also discuss some positive aspects, some message of hope, and then inshallah I'm going to transition this talk to the month of Ramadan. I want to share with you some observation. There was a ICU nurse for 35 years. And you know, when you work in ICU intensive care, the thing is that you see death every day. So she had written a book about her observation, what were the thoughts going through the mind of people who are about to die. And she has mentioned those as a five regrets. The first regret, they all have said that we have wasted a lot of our time. The second thing, we have transgressed the rights of many people. We have hurt many of our family members. We have only enjoyed not even 30% of the bounties we had. And the last regret they had, that we have not thanked enough to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bounties we have received in this dunya. We were not grateful enough on the bounties. You know, after 9/11, the people who were caught on certain floors and there was no escape for them, there is a museum where they have recorded their conversation, last minute conversation with their loved ones. And those conversations are part of record in the museum now. And the regrets people had in those conversations, I wish I would have told you how much I love you. I wish I have said sorry to you. I wish I have lived my life in a different way. I wish I have enjoyed what I had in this life. Common regrets for most of the people who are about to die. If you recall Quran, stories from the Quran, the people on the Day of Judgment, they will have the same regret, and they will plea to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that give us a chance so that we can go back and we will be a better servant of you, Ya Rabbul Alameen. And that's why, you know, that day, the Day of Judgment, is called Yom-e-Hasra. I will share with you, you know, one of the sayings of Imam Ghazali, Rahmatullah Alayh. You know about Imam Ghazali, the beautiful thing is that he gives us examples in such a way that we can never forget those examples. He says, there are people who have to go through a tunnel. There is a passage under the tunnel which is very dark. Dark that you cannot even see your own hand. Very dark tunnel the people have to pass through, to go through. There were some wise people standing on the other side of the tunnel, and they were advising whoever has to go through that tunnel that whenever you pass through this tunnel, whatever pebbles, stone you see on your way, collect them. Collect them and save them. So there were people, he said, you know, going through a tunnel is a hardship, you know, anyway. So, and then he is asking for another hardship of collecting these pebbles. We will not do this. Let's just pass through. And there were some people, they took their advice and they said, these are wise people. Maybe there is wisdom behind it. So they collected some of the pebbles and stones on their way when they were going through the tunnel. Once they reached on the other side of the tunnel and they saw what they had in their hands, what they collected, those were precious stones, diamonds and gold. My brothers and my sisters, now look at the feelings of the people who have rejected the advice of these wise people. And they were biting their arms and hands and regretting, hasra, that we wish that we would have also listened to those wise people advising us to collect these pebbles and these stones. But the people who have collected some, they will also regret, we wish we would have collected more. My brothers and my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent more or less 124,000 messengers on this planet to teach you and me that when you are going through this tunnel of this dunya, collect the pebbles. Your fasting is your pebble, your salah is your pebble, your sadaqah is your pebble, your good deeds, these are those stones. They don't have any tangible value today. But tomorrow, when the darkness of this tunnel will be over and the noor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make these pebbles to shine, then you will realize the value of these deeds you have done in this dunya. My brothers and my sisters, there was a salaf. He said, you know, whenever we go through any trial of the dunya, there are three reasons we should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what. The first reason is the trial is of something related to dunya. It's not the trial of your iman. So if it's trial of a dunya, thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has not put you in the trial of your iman. The second reason that you should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it could have been worse. It would have been worse than what it is. So you should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever condition you are in. It could be worse. And the third reason to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if you will show patience on the hardship and calamity and mushkil you are going through, there is a reward for you in that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reward for that patience. My brothers and my sisters, I want to talk to you a few things to connect our certain condition today with Ramadan. See, people who are about to die, you have heard their regrets. The people in the hellfire, you have heard their regrets. You and me, we are still alive. We have the opportunity. That's why one of the story of Abu Huraira, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that one time he was passing by a cemetery, graveyard, Qabristan, and all of a sudden he stopped his riding animal and he started praying two rak'ah. So people around him asked him, Abu Huraira, what happened to you that all of a sudden you stopped your animal and then you started praying? He said, I recall the saying of the Prophet ﷺ, the biggest wish, hasra, of the people in grave will not be like they want to conquer the world or they want to collect this dunya. The biggest wish of the people of grave will be if Allah can allow them to go back and pray two rak'ah salah. My brothers, And my sister Abu Huraira said, they are wishing. And to me, Allah has given this chance that I can pray two rakah. So that's why I stopped. Brothers and sisters, you and me, we have the opportunity. And blessing on top of another blessing, that the blessed month of Ramadan is approaching you and me. So we have to plan ahead so that we can benefit from this month of Ramadan as much as we could. To benefit from the month of Ramadan, I want to share with you few things. Number one, my brothers and my sisters, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu has said one thing. There is no trial, tribulation, calamity comes on you except it comes because of your sins. And no hardship and calamity and mushkil Allah removes without tawbah. So first thing we should do, we should do istighfar. And for istighfar, there is one requirement, my brothers and my sisters, that we have to diagnose our disease. We have to diagnose our problem, our issues. So for that, the first thing I will ask you and myself, let's do our ruthless ihtisab, accountability. Let's do our accountability without mercy. Because most of the time, when we do accountability, we exempt ourselves. We feel like, you know, I'm fine, I'm doing good, everybody else is doing wrong. But wallahi, until and unless I will identify my problem, my disease, my issues, I will not be able to rectify them. I will not be able to progress. I will not be able to make the sincere tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In tawbah, it is very much required that you should accept your weakness in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should, the way we were acting, you know, I have said in another video, whatever situation we were in, if I was the in charge of my house, or I was the in charge of my company, or I was the in charge of a country, we all were acting like a pharaoh, that we have all the power, and we were transgressing the rights of people right and left. Remember one thing, brothers and sisters, end of the day, we all are from one family. All human beings are one family. So we have to make sure we treat everybody equally. Does not matter what religion they have, what color they have, what country they have, what social status they have. Wallahi, we have transgressed the right of the people who were under us. If I was the head of the house, I have transgressed the rights of my wife, my children. Same way, if I am the owner of the company, if I am the Malaka, the queen of the house, if the servants are coming to work in my house, how I have treated them? What has happened all around the world? We were saying, no, this is has nothing to do with whatever was happening in Syria. So many people died. You know, so many people were killed in Iraq. So many people have died all around the world. And as a human being, we never felt the pain of those people who are suffering. So my brothers, we have to do our ihtisab, that as a human being, as an individual, whatever my responsibilities are, I'm going to fulfill those responsibilities. I will be a better person as a father, as a mother, as a brother, as a sister. And I will be a better person as a part of the community at large. And I will be a better human being because we all are from one family, all the human beings. And we should respect all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first thing, that we should do our accountability. The second thing I will say, my brothers and my sisters, that we should commit. We should refresh our commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should refresh our iman. We should become a better Muslim. We should have better relationship with Quran. We should have better connection, you know, with our salah. we have ignored. Remember, see how much we miss going to, for masjid. You know, I was looking at a picture of Kaaba yesterday and I was crying because I was wishing that I wish I can go and do my tawaf, do my umrah. But we cannot. Allah had given us the opportunity, but we missed. That's why the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he said, people neglect two blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. Number one is their health, and number two is the free time. And there is another hadith of Prophet ﷺ in which he said, if you wake up in the morning and you have safety outside your home, you are not afraid of going outside because of the war or because of the virus or because of any other fear, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you health and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you sustenance of that day, that means Allah has provided you, Allah has presented you the bounties of the whole universe. And we appreciate this hadith today more than yesterday, my brothers and my sisters. So let's refresh our iman, our commitment, that we will be a better human being after we pass through this crisis. To Ramadan is a month that in which we can develop ourselves. Do not waste your time. Value your time. You know, there was a Salaf, he was put in jail one time, and then one of his colleague in the jail, he came to him and he said, why don't I share with you some poetry to kill some time? The Salaf said, you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put us in this trial of jail, then we should be more in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instead of, you know, killing our time or going away from the obedience and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, if we are killing our time at our home and we are not valuing the free time we have, wallahi, that means we have missed the point. We have missed the point. So the month of Ramadan is the month that I should plan that how I am going to connect with Quran, that I will read Quran, not only just Nazira, but I will read with translation. I will try to memorize some portions of Quran. I will try to read some tafsir of Quran. I will have some book which can connect me with better understanding of my religion. I will have some self-development program. There are so many different programs available for self-development. So I can plan something that I will follow this roadmap during the Ramadan to become a better Muslim, a better human being, a better father, a better mother, a better son and daughter. My brothers, do not waste your time. In the last, I want to share with you one hadith of Prophet Sallam, and this is a hadith of Qudsi. And listen to this hadith, my brothers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the oath of His Izzah and Jalal. And He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will not let my true servant die until I have my rahmah on him. I will not take away his soul until I will put him in a trial of his maal, his awlad, and his ahl. And if he still has some left sins on him, then I am going to make his sakratul maut, his death time, little bit harder on him. So when he dies, he has no sins on him. And when he meets me, he meets like a newborn baby is given birth by his mother just now. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to clean my sin that I have done in this dunya. So if I am going through any hardship, my brothers and my sister, I should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because wallahi, our ultimate goal of life should be akhirah. That's why, you know, sahaba, if they have done any mistake in their life, they have rushed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, because they knew in this dunya, no matter what I will achieve, no matter how much I will have, I can only enjoy for certain period of time. But the life hereafter, which is khayran wa abqa, la aisha illa aisha al-akhira. The akhira is the real life that I want to see success. And I, when I come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I want to hear only one voice. Ya ayyatuhan nafsul mutmainna irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiya fadkhuli fi ibadi wadkhuli jannati. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my brothers and my sisters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you and me tawfiq that we can pass this month of Ramadan in the best condition. Let's take advantage. This is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that in this situation He is giving you and me this opportunity that we can have a blessed month, and is that blessed month we can get more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I will close with one more hadith. There was a, and I will ask one thing we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the month of Ramadan and even before that, whenever we raise our hands. And in about dua, always remember, before I share that hadith with you, dua is not, you know, about words, what you say. Dua is what coming from your heart. Wallahi, a lot of time we get lost in words, reading from this book, reading from that book. Nothing wrong in that. But Allah wants the connection between your heart and your tongue. So when you raise your hands in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Him one thing. Give you contained heart. Give you qana'at. Make your heart qane, contained, that you are satisfied in whatever condition Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps you. Now I'll share, because this is a time of greed. People are fighting, struggling, one, you know, level of, you know, achievement to next level of achievement, and people are, you know, violating rights of other people, but there is a rush to have some success of this dunya, and they forget about everything around them. They forget about akhirah. But people who have contained heart, their condition is different. There was a group of people came from Yemen to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they visited Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the end Prophet asked Hazrat Bilal to give them some gifts. And when Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was giving gifts to them, he asked them, do you have anybody left I have not given gift to? They said, you know, we have one person from our group and we left him outside so he can watch our stuff. So Hazrat Bilal said, then send him inside. This man comes and he sits next to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks him that, do you have any wish, any desire? Look at the reply of this young man. He says to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Rasulullah, I did not come here to collect any gifts on any worldly thing from you. I came here just to ask you to make one dua for me. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ask what dua you want me to ask. He said, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me qane qalb, to give me contained heart. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised his hand and, you know, praised, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and made this dua for him, for qane heart. That group went back to Yemen. After many years, when Prophet ﷺ went for Hajj, the same group came back for Hajj. And they reminded Prophet ﷺ, you know, we were in Medina, we visited you, and Prophet remembered. And look at the quality of a leader, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at the quality of the... He remembered that young man who was not there at that time with them during the Hajj. So he asked the group, what is the condition of that young man that who was with you when you visited me in Medina? They say, ya Rasulullah, his condition is very ajeeb, different. You know, if we are distributing the wealth of this world, this man has nothing to do, like he has nothing to do what we are distributing among ourselves. He is so kind. Look at the words of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him, and I am very sure when he will going to die, he will going to have a death of peace. Death of peace. He is going to die in peace because his eyes are not going to look right and left for all the treasures he has collected. But rather, he will go with peace because his heart is content and he has given his heart to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he saves, you know, everybody, all the human beings, all the living creatures on this planet. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, remove all the hardship and difficulties we are going through today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you and me this tawfiq, this opportunity that we learn our lesson from the hardship and difficulty we are going through, and we become a better human being once we pass through this hardship. Wa akhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.